Today's scripture reading is from Acts, starting the last verse of chapter 12, and then going on to verse 12, verses 13. Starting Acts 12, verse 25. And Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem when they had completed their service, bringing with them John, whose other name was John. Now there were at the church at Antioch prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, whose name was Niger, Lucius, Cyrene, Manine, lifelong friend, Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. Then after fasting and praying, they laid their hands on them and sent them off. So being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia, and from there they sailed to Cyprus. When they arrived at Salamis, they proclaimed the word of God in the synagogue of the Jews, and they had John to assist them. When they had gone through the whole island as far as Paphos, they came upon a certain magician, a Jewish false prophet named Bar-Jesus. He was proconsul of Sergius Paulus, a man of intelligence who summoned Barnabas and Saul and sought to hear the word of God. But Emmaus, the magician, for that was the meaning of the name, opposed them, seeking to turn the proconsul away from the faith. But Saul, who was also called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked intently at him and said, "You son of the devil, you enemy of all righteousness, full of all deceit and villainy, will you not stop making crooked the straight paths of the Lord? And now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon you, and you will be blind and unable to see the sun for a time." Immediately, mist and darkness fell upon him, and he went out, seeking people to lead him by the hand. Then the proconsul believed. He saw what had occurred, for he was astonished.
Jasper enjoyed working at a hotel. It gave him joy to make people stay as positive as possible. He prided himself on making sure that every detail was taken care of. The towels were folded to look like seashells. Bed sheets were tucked in as tight as a drum. Even the toilet paper was folded with a little triangle at the top. No detail was too small for Jasper. But one day, Jasper was shocked when he came to work. He smelled smoke. He ran into the kitchen, but there was no fire there. So he ran up the stairs until the smell of the smoke was so overwhelming. When he opened the door to the fourth floor, he ran right into Charlie. "Charlie, there's a fire!" Charlie looked surprised. "Well, do we know for sure that there's a fire? I mean, the smoke alarms aren't going off. Is it really that bad?" Now Jasper was surprised. "Of course it's bad. It's 1,000 degrees up here. It stinks like smoke. And look, the ceiling's catching fire." Charlie straightened up. "Right, well, we'd better go downstairs. We don't want to get caught up here." He started to pull Jasper towards the door. "No, no, we have to warn the people. We have to get them out of here." "Oh no, we don't want to do that. They're sound asleep. We don't want to bother them over a silly little fire. I say we should let them sleep in." You're probably thinking that this Charlie character sounds ridiculous. At least I hope he does. Of course we should wake people up if there's a fire. This is no time for being polite. Go bang on the doors, shake them until they wake up. Because if you don't, you're going to die. This is the sense of urgency we see in today's passage. When we read Paul's words to Bar-Jesus, it's easy for us to think he needs to calm down. He's calling him a son of the devil, an enemy of righteousness. Clearly, Paul needs to be a nicer person. He needs to be more kind to this false teacher. But when you understand what's at stake, when you see someone leading people away from salvation, you need to act fast. There's no time for a debate. That's why Paul jumps into action. He knows that Bar-Jesus is dangerous. His deceptions aren't something to take lightly. He's leading people away from Christ and into a fire far worse than any we could imagine. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for who you are, Lord. We thank you ultimately for your gospel, for sending Christ to die in our place so that we can have fellowship with you, Lord. And we just pray that as we read this passage today, we would learn some hard truths from the example we see in Paul, the urgency we need to preserve the gospel. In your name I pray. Amen. Here we see a shift in the narrative. The book of Acts starts off recording the events of Peter and the apostles. Then we had an interlude where we saw a lot of different characters, Stephen, Philip, and Saul. And we heard from Peter one more time. He shared how the gospel had gone out to the Gentiles. The rest of the book from here on out is going to be primarily about Paul. You see, God has a message in the book of Acts. It's a message that isn't about any particular character. It's about him. It's about his Spirit's work in the early church. Whether it's through Peter or Paul, the main character is always God. Verse 1. Now there were in the church at Antioch prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, a lifelong friend of Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. In Antioch, we see that there are prophets and teachers. They're a mixed bag of people. Some are from Africa. Manaen is an aristocrat, someone who grew up alongside Herod. It's interesting to note, the Herod he grew up next to was Herod Antipas, the one who beheaded John the Baptist. Now, Manaen is an influential character in the early church. So we see in this group people who are foreigners alongside people who were former persecutors. Now Manaen might not have participated in the beheading of John the Baptist, but for some reason there's a special notice of his relationship with Herod. Not only are there people of different backgrounds listed, there are people of different functions, namely prophets and teachers. These were both important to have in the early church because they were establishing something new. They needed direct instructions from God because they didn't have the New Testament scriptures, so they needed these prophets to speak God's words to them. There were also teachers, those who were able to pass on these instructions to others. They can explain how and why things need to be done. Verse 2. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work which I have called them." Who spoke to them? It says here that the Holy Spirit said these words. And the Holy Spirit had also spoken to Peter back in chapter 10. This means that the Holy Spirit is a personal being. It's easy for us to think of the Holy Spirit as a force, as a type of spiritual energy. But as we study Scripture, we see that the Holy Spirit is intimately involved in communicating to the church. One could even argue that that's the primary role of the Holy Spirit. We saw Peter filled with the Holy Spirit and then go on to deliver a message to the Sanhedrin. We also saw the church filled with the Holy Spirit speaking the word of God with boldness. When people disputed with Stephen, it is said, but they could not withstand the wisdom and the spirit with which he was speaking. So it should come as no surprise to see the Holy Spirit instructing the church in Antioch. He's very active in communicating with mankind. In fact, he is the means through which we get our holy scriptures, God's instruction to the church today. We should never think that the Holy Spirit is not moving in our churches today. He's still at work, even though we don't see an abundance of miracles. Don't get me wrong, there are still miracles being done today, just not to the extent and regularity with which you see in the early church. Needless to say, the Holy Spirit is still moving in churches today, even though we aren't seeing healings every Sunday. Because every time God's truth is revealed to us, the Spirit is at work. In this verse, we are seeing direct communication. Holy Spirit said. He gives specific instructions for Barnabas and Saul to be set apart. But upon receiving this calling by the Holy Spirit, Saul and Barnabas set off with the church's blessing. Verse 3 closes off by saying the church had sent them off. And verse 4 says they were sent out by the Holy Spirit. This is just a picture of how the church is supposed to function. As the Holy Spirit directs people, their actions affirm what he is already doing. The church is working harmoniously with the Holy Spirit. It's important for us to fully grasp that this is all ordained by the Holy Spirit, because we're going to hear a harsh confrontation. This passage is making it abundantly clear that what happens next is affirmed by God. Verse 5. When they arrived at Salamis, they proclaimed the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews. And they had John to assist them. When they had gone through the whole island as far as Paphos, they came upon a certain magician, a Jewish false prophet named Bar-Jesus. Here we see Barnabas and Saul doing the task they were sent out to do, proclaiming the word of God. They start off in the synagogues. They're going to the Jews first. This becomes standard practice for Paul. Whenever he goes to a new place, he gives the gospel to the Jews first. When these men arrived at Paphos, which was the capital of the island, it was also known for the worship of Venus, the goddess of love. This has been a strange journey. They're seeing a multitude of synagogues, meaning that there's a strong Jewish presence. But as they continue their journey to the city, you see that they're in pagan territory. There are competing beliefs and worldviews in this area. And we see an example of these competing beliefs play out. We are introduced to Bar-Jesus, who's also called Elymas, which means magician. Luke leaves us no guesswork as to whether he's a good guy or a bad guy. Bar-Jesus is called a Jewish false prophet. He's the one who speaks lies. Well, Jesus actually warned his followers about false prophets. Mark 13. For false Christs and false prophets will arise and perform signs and wonders to lead many astray. Bar-Jesus fits this description of a false prophet perfectly. He's performing magic, seeking to lead this proconsul away from the faith. Verse 7. He was with the proconsul, Sergius Paulus, man of intelligence, who summoned Barnabas and Saul and sought to hear the word of God. But Elymas, the magician, for that is the meaning of his name, opposed them, seeking to turn the proconsul away from the faith. Bar-Jesus was with the Roman proconsul, Sergius Paulus. He's called a man of intelligence. And here we see him summoning Barnabas and Paul. He wants them to share the word of God with them. He's eager to hear. This is the mark of an intelligent man. Till now, there have been emotional people. The Sanhedrin gets very offended at the word of God spoken through the apostles. They never considered that their words might be true. And before the stoning of Stephen, we saw the religious leaders covering their ears and shouting. They refused to even listen. But this Roman proconsul, he shows more interest in the gospel than the religious elite, because he's seeking the truth. And then we see Bar-Jesus, Elymas. He's described to us as being a magician and a false prophet. This isn't the first time we've seen a magician in Acts. Back in Samaria, we read about Simon the magician. He was seeking the power of God apart from repentance. And Peter rebuked him harshly. But Peter also called Simon to repentance. So there's some similarities in these stories. But like most things in Acts, things are escalating. At least Simon was only harming himself. He wasn't like Bar-Jesus. Simon was selfish and sinful, but Bar-Jesus is actively harming others. So we see that he is given a far more intense rebuke. We see him opposing the truth. He's actively seeking to turn the proconsul away from the faith. He is that false prophet that Jesus talked about. He's a magician, someone who's performing signs and wonders. And his main goal is to lead this man astray. This gives us more context as to what's going to follow. This man is truly an enemy of the cross. There's nothing worse that a person could do than to purposefully and knowingly lead people away from Christ. He's leading people away from the God who loves them. Ultimately, he's leading them through the gates of hell. On that positive note, I want to take a moment to look at something interesting. So let's just put that all on the shelf for a moment. Because in this passage, there's a little phrase that's said and we quickly move past it. It says that Saul was also called Paul. From this point forward, that's all that he is called. This interested me. Why does this name change happen? Is there a reason for it? After all, when Peter had his name changed, it meant something. Jesus said to him, "Simon Bar-Jonah, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." One thing that's interesting about Peter's name change is that it's initiated by Jesus. It's not something that Peter or his parents came up with. Jesus changed his name for a reason. Because Peter means rock. And as Jesus goes on to say, Peter was the rock that the church was built on. He was that immovable stone that would propel the church into existence. This is what we have seen played out in the book of Acts. But in the case of Paul, his name change was not initiated by God. Throughout the rest of the book, Luke refers to him as Paul. It's assumed that he took on this name from this day forward. But the name Paul was not something that he suddenly came up with. It's actually common for people at this time to have two names. They would have a Hebrew name and a name from where they were born. And Saul was born in the Roman city of Tarsus. So he was named both Saul and Paul, one Hebrew name and one Roman name. This is similar to my Ukrainian mom. Her Ukrainian name is Marusia, and she is also called Marie. And I've been told that my Ukrainian name is Timofey. If I ever go to the Ukraine, I might consider going by Timofey, but for now, I'll stick with Tim. So Saul already had the name Paul. He only now starts using it because his ministry shifts from Jews towards Gentiles. This has nothing to do with his conversion. That was a long time ago. He's now speaking to a Roman proconsul. This is why he's now using his Roman name. Why doesn't Paul go back to Saul when he speaks to the Jews again? From this point on, he sticks with the name Paul. Most assume that this was the way of his abandoning his status as a Jew. He's trying to show the Gentiles that the gospel is for all people, regardless of their heritage. In this way, Paul has become all things to all people, that by all means he might save some. He's taking on his Gentile name to relate to the Gentiles. And Saul had every right to be proud of his Hebrew name. He was named after the first king of Israel, King Saul. And like King Saul, he too was from the tribe of Benjamin. And Saul was a mighty man. He was described to be a head above all the other men of Israel. What a prestigious namesake. So knowing the significance of the name Saul, we might wonder, what does Paul mean? Paul, surprisingly, means little or small. So he's leaving behind his distinguished name in order to take on a lowly name. He isn't going to put any confidence in his heritage, only in Christ. In this way, he shows that he has the same heart as John the Baptist, who said, "He must increase, but I must decrease." This is an act of humility on the part of Paul. One final thing I want to note before getting to the good stuff, to his flaming rebuke, the final thing I want to mention is that there is a continual emphasis that Paul is doing God's will. This is not an instance of him flying off the handle. Though there is some mention of some of the apostles having bad conduct in this book, this is not one of those instances. Just look at the language that has been used leading up to this point. Verse 2 says that they were worshiping and fasting. It's clear that they were seeking God's will. Not only that, the Holy Spirit is the one who speaks to them. It says that the Holy Spirit calls Saul and Barnabas for this work. Verse 4 echoes this sentiment by saying they were sent out by the Holy Spirit. We could still argue that they were sent out in a direction to the proconsul, meaning Paul's words weren't approved, only the journey, the direction. Except for the fact that right before his rebuke, verse 9 says he was filled with the Holy Spirit. Whenever Peter was filled with the Holy Spirit, his message was of utmost importance. Being filled with the Spirit implies that the words that come after are directly from God. This is God's message to Bar-Jesus. So let's look at what he's saying. Verse 9, Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked intently at him and said, "You son of the devil, you enemy of all righteousness, full of deceit and villainy, will you not stop making crooked the straight paths of the Lord?" Wow, you could not speak more plainly if you tried. These are some of the harshest words spoken from one person to another in Scripture. And they're God's words. Why is this? Why does God speak such a harsh word to Bar-Jesus? Remember, he was purposefully and knowingly trying to lead Sergius Paulus away from the gospel. This man wasn't looking for a debate. This isn't the type of person you win over with reason, because Bar-Jesus wasn't interested in the truth. He was sided with the devil. Paul calls him the son of the devil. Now, this phrase doesn't come out of nowhere. It's used elsewhere in Scripture. Jesus uses such harsh words for people in John chapter 8. You are of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and a father of lies. There are people who want nothing to do with the truth. In this way, they are children of the devil. They would rather speak lies than listen to the truth. We see this phrase further explained in 1 John chapter 3, where it says, whoever makes a practice of sinning is of the devil. By this it is evident who are the children of God and who are the children of the devil. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is the one who does not love his brother. The children of the devil are those who are experts of lawlessness. They're inventors of evil. They're actively seeking to practice and promote wickedness. These are the types of people who need to be rebuked, especially those who are seeking to pull others away from Christ. So Paul is right to call Bar-Jesus the son of the devil, an enemy of righteousness. Paul's rebuke goes beyond mere words. Verse 11, and now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon you, and you will be blind, unable to see the sun for a time. Immediately mist and darkness fell upon him, and he went about seeking people to lead him by the hand. Again, there is no mistaking that the anger Paul is showing is a righteous anger, because God follows through with Paul's curse by making Bar-Jesus blind. Paul issues this curse of blindness, and then darkness falls on Bar-Jesus. We're seeing him looking for people to lead him by the hand. Some of you might have made this connection. Didn't Paul have to be led by the hand? Remember on the road to Damascus? After Jesus appeared to Paul, he became blind. And people had to lead him by the hand. This was to show that Paul was spiritually blind. But after his conversion, the scales fell off his eyes, and he could see again. This passage shows the exact reversal of Paul's experience. Instead of scales falling off, darkness falls on Bar-Jesus, because he had the opposite of belief. He was attacking the truth. He was an enemy of the cross. So Paul is giving a physical affirmation that Bar-Jesus is spiritually blind. He's not somebody you should follow. He now needs other people to guide him by the hand. Bar-Jesus looks incredibly powerless now. So how does the proconsul react to all of this? What's his response? Verse 12, then the proconsul believed when he saw what had occurred. He was astonished at the teaching of the Lord. He believed when he saw what had happened. He saw how Bar-Jesus was powerless against Paul's God. But this wasn't why he believed. This was the journey toward belief. He was actually won over by the teaching. It says, because he was astonished at the teaching of the Lord. Signs and wonders are never what saves people. They point people in the right direction. We are never called to put our faith in signs. It's like walking around a fair, being impressed by the colorful lights on the rides. Unless you step onto the ride, you're missing out on the whole experience. The message, the gospel, that is what saves. Much like the healings affirm the apostles' message, this curse affirms Paul's message. God is powerful in both his healing and his judgment, and his truth will not be hindered. Whether people believe or not, he is still in control. He is still sovereign. Bar-Jesus isn't the only false prophet mentioned in Scripture. Many of the New Testament letters have warnings about false teachers. And Jesus warned that there will be many false prophets in the last days. So it's safe to say that if there were false prophets then, false prophets to come, odds are they exist today. They might not manifest themselves in such ways as the Old Testament prophets. They likely won't be found making sacrifices to Baal or practicing magic. But we are told to be on guard against deceitful teachers, those who teach a false Jesus, false gospel. So we need to be on guard. This doesn't mean that any preacher who makes a doctrinal error is a false teacher. There's no such thing as a perfect preacher or teacher. These warnings are specifically for those who are actively teaching lies. Warnings are against those who deny the nature of Jesus and who pervert the gospel. Because if we aren't believing in Jesus as the way to the Father, then we are damned. That's why Scripture has some of its harshest words for these false teachers, to those who seek to lead others astray. Let me quickly show you some of these passages in order to give you just a glimpse of the serious tone Scripture takes towards false teachers. In Galatians 1, there are some who trouble you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one we preach to you, let him be accursed. As we've said before, so now I say again, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to the one you receive, let him be accursed. This is a stern condemnation. Let him be accursed. Because we don't need to allow people in our churches to preach a false gospel. It's unloving to those who would hear his words. If we want to be loving, the best thing we can do is shut down false teaching. In 2 Peter chapter 2, there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. But these, blaspheming about matters which they are ignorant, will also be destroyed in their destruction. Suffering wrong is the wage for their wrongdoing. Needless to say, Scripture promises a severe consequence for these false teachers. The last verse I'll show you is from Jesus himself, Matthew 7. Jesus says, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves." I think it's important for us to understand, to know that we aren't supposed to tolerate false teachings. We tend to value politeness as Canadians, but as Christians, we cannot take a polite approach to false doctrines being preached. I know it can be confusing for us to read about such harsh words as Paul's rebuke to Bar Jesus, but when we consider the damage that is being done by these false teachers, we can see that he is actually being loving. Loving to those who are following these deceitful teachers. There was a documentary that came out in 2018 called American Gospel. It exposed some of the false teachings that are popular in our Western culture. It also spent a lot of time emphasizing the true gospel. Many Bible-believing Christians were excited to have such a resource. They could use this as a way to start conversations with friends and family who are caught up with false gospels. But not all Christians were excited about this documentary. Many were opposed. I'm not talking about those who were believers of the false gospels. Of course they were opposed. But there were many Bible-believing Christians who thought it was wrong of these people to criticize false teachers. It wasn't very nice. The problem with this reasoning is that we end up condemning Paul and Peter for using unkind words. Even Jesus used unkind words. He called the Pharisees a brood of vipers and whitewashed tombs. And he even told them that they were better off dead than to lead these little ones astray. We need to be careful not to allow our culture's values and definitions of love. Be careful not to let our cultures influence how we approach Scripture, how we interpret Scripture. The gospel is a treasure. It's our lifeline. We need to keep our teaching pure. I know this topic can be misunderstood. It can almost be sound like I'm promoting being judgmental, or that we should pride ourselves on our doctrinal knowledge. Please come back next week, as I will preach on judgmentalism. It's important for us to be aware of the extremes of both sides, of not confronting false teaching, as well as using doctrine against others. Neither are right, so please come back next week as we look at this topic more. But today I want to leave you with this thought. I doubt many of us would turn a blind eye to a drug dealer in an elementary school. How would we react to someone leading our children to play in a busy street? Would we engage in a dialogue with them? Would we debate the merits of not doing drugs or not playing in the streets? No, we would take immediate action. We would call the police or rebuke such a person because they're leading children into life-threatening activities. Neither should we allow poison to be spoken amongst those we love. We do not hate the false teacher. We can rebuke them. It's actually the qualification for being a pastor or elder to be able to rebuke false teaching. You need to keep the wolves away from the flock. So for you today, in your homes, among your family, teach them to be on guard. The best way to be on guard against false teaching is to be familiar with true teaching. Teach your family and friends about the true gospel, about the hope that we have in Christ, about the great love of God displayed on the cross. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for your power that you displayed at the cross, your love that you showed towards us at the cross. And we pray that we would preserve that, God. We wouldn't let the devil come in to deceive people and ultimately to lead them away from the hope that they can have in you. Help us to be wise as we do this too, Father. In the name of